Hello, I'm Father Louie Scurti, and I welcome you to Friends of the Word. Today, we'll continue the ordinary time of the year, second Sunday of ordinary time, and each of us are called to renew our own baptismal thoughts and memories and calling. People answered for us when we were born, now it's time to answer for ourselves. Thank you for joining us, and pass this on to your family and friends, and let me hear from you, Father Louie Scurti at hotmail.com. God bless you. The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. John the Baptist saw Jesus coming toward him and said, "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. He is the one of whom I said, 'A man is coming after me who ranks ahead of me, because he existed before me.' I did not know him, but the reason why I came baptizing with water was that he might be made known to Israel." John testified further, saying, "I saw the Spirit come down like a dove from heaven and remain upon him. I did not know him, but the one who sent me to baptize with water told me, 'On whomever you see the Spirit come down and remain, he is the one who will baptize with the Holy Spirit.' Now I have seen and testified that he is the Son of God." The Gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Ordinary time of the year for the Christian. Maybe ordinary time beginning also basically calendar-wise, the beginning of the year. Might be a time for us to stop and take a look at ourselves and our relationship with God. That's certainly what's going on in the scriptures today as Jesus is just baptized and John experiences who he is, the Son of God, the one upon whom the Spirit came. So from there on, Jesus starts letting us know who he is. So we could look at our own callings, at our own baptisms. There was a baptism earlier today. And the parents and godparents responded for the promises of the church on behalf of the child. Most of us were in that situation. Someone responded for us. And we were being called to be invited into the family of God, to be bearers of the light of God, to be Christians, to be those who carry Christ to others. And of course, Christ was certainly identified once he left John and went on to his mission. He certainly was identified by what he said and did. And so are we. We're identified by what we say and what we do. What we say and what we do identifies who we are. Whether we know it or not, we're mirroring who we are to others so they can see if we are people who follow the Christ, who are people who really hold on to the fact that the Son of God came to us and asks us to be his brother and sister and members of his family. As we begin the new year, we look at John. It was almost like love at first sight because, yes, they were cousins. He was Elizabeth's child, and Mary, of course, gave birth to Jesus a few months apart. They were cousins, but who knows, according to scriptures or history, how well they knew each other. John says, "I didn't know him. I didn't know him when he came down. I didn't know this is going to be the one. But the inspiration that I received was that when the Spirit comes upon almost like a dove, like comes upon that one that I baptize, he's the one who is going to be the Son of God who will baptize in the Spirit. And it was almost like a love at first sight with John. He fell in love, not romantic love with his cousin, but he fell in love with Jesus and encouraged his own followers. That's the one. He's the new Lamb of God. And there's various ways of, in Aramaic and at that time, of saying what Lamb of God meant. A mother or child could certainly be, and we use that today too, a parent could certainly call their child my little lamb, okay? Definitely my son. Definitely that one who's filled with life. And all of it comes together today, even as in the Old Testament, as we hear the prophet Isaiah using other words, you are my servant, I'm going to give you glory, you carry my glory to other people. That's another phrase, that the servant, the son, the special child, the lamb, all synonymous with being God's kid, you know? You're really, but that applies to any of us. We're all God's children, all God's kids. But this one, a little different. This is the one who would be, when he leaves you, John the Baptist is being told, when he leaves you, he's going to be baptizing with the Holy Spirit. So he's the fulfillment of the relationship, the paternal and childlike relationship between him and God the Father. So he goes on, and I think at times it's good for us to look at ourselves and look at how we've been called. And you gotta realize, every one of us has been called to do something and to be who we are. It's really important to realize that it's not only the priests or the nuns or the Pope or the holy people who are officially holy people, the hierarchy. We are not the only ones called to respond to God's will. All of us are in our own way. But it means, like Jesus, we have to be in union with God. Jesus was, that's one of his key attributes for us. His constant union with God. He was in prayer with God. But again, this is his father, so it's as if any of us could be in dialogue with our parent, or our child, or our best friend, or our spouse. That kind of relationship, that of self-knowledge, knowing myself through my relationship to this other person, child, parent, boyfriend, girlfriend, doesn't matter. We get to know ourselves when we see ourselves mirrored in other people's behaviors. You show me someone who doesn't like people, and I'll tell you someone who doesn't like him or herself. And show me someone who's mean to people, and I'll show you someone who's really down on him or herself. It's only a reflection. How we know God and how we know ourselves is a reflection of one another. You love God, you try to get him into your life, good. That's what we're trying to do each day. And that certainly is reflected, I hope, and it has to be if it's consistent, in how we get along with other people. You can say, I love God all you want. Don't respect people. That's a crock. You're just full of it. You love God. We love God. And John says that. I mean, I just, hey, God forbid I should put words in God's mouth. But John says, the person who says, I love my neighbor, I love God but hates my neighbor, is a liar. That's John's letter. So we're back to here. So it's good for us to look at ourselves. And I thought, you know what? You guys know me. You've heard my stories. But let me give you some of the stories that brought me to this point here. And again, I'm not doing it for my sake, but I'm using Jesus and John the Baptist, who were brought to this point at the beginning of the ministry. And as we look through the developing ministry in Jesus' life and John's life, we realize who they were and what they were doing. When we were kids, my mother would take us to Jaime Shoemaker. We didn't go to big name places. We went to Jaime's down the avenue. And every Easter, Christmas, and September, that's when we got our new shoes. Jaime would say, it was a beautiful little store. It had a little potbelly stove. It had that smell of the oil floors. And he would say, Louie, Michael, what are you going to be when you grow up? And needless to say, Jaime spoke Yiddish, and he was a Jewish person, and we loved him, and he was a friend of my family for years. And my mother would answer before we had a chance, and the same answer came out every time. Well, one's going to be a priest, and one's going to be a fighter.
She called it
for both of us. Michael was often involved with fights on the football field and school and all that. And I don't know about this priest stuff. I was a kid and, you know, I was an altar boy. But how many of you were altar boys and servers and participants in church growing up? We didn't necessarily all become priests. My mother, she nailed it. But there were other things that would, as time went on, would seem to be a deterrent, like the number of times I got in trouble in high school. You know, you have a Sicilian mother, you're never in trouble, because Sicilian boys do no wrong. So I was in trouble with the nuns, the Irish nuns, God forbid. I was in trouble even with the nuns at Holy Rosary, but my mother always was right there, proving that I was not wrong, although she was wrong. She proved that her son did no wrong, and the son walked on water, you know, my lamb, my son, my special, you know, you get the idea. In high school, same thing. And the joke was, it's a terrible, this is not confession. One Lent, Sister Rose, what was her name? Maria something or other, Sister Maria, said, because I was always like standing out in the crowd, she said, Louie, I'm going to give you a job during Lent. Okay, what's the job? You're going to pass the mission box. Remember the little cardboard mission boxes? And I said, okay. So after lunch, I would shake down all my classmates, because that was pushy and bold, and we were buddies. And I said, come on. I saw how much change you got back from lunch. Come on, put it in the mission box. And one day I realized through the season of Lent, I'm sorry, Jesus, that the mission box, if you shake it long enough and loud enough, some of it comes out to the bottom. So, okay. Now, this was the joke. At the end of the class, each time after lunch, I'd do the collection, and I'd put the mission box back on Sister Maria's desk. What was in the mission box went to God, and what was in my hand went to me. God forbid. It's an apology. I made up for it since then many times. But the kids knew it, you know? So one day, she caught on, too. She was a wise old cracker. She caught on, and I was, you know, she says, Lou, she says, come here. She says, in front of the class, she says, you know, you do that so well, collecting money. Thank you. Have you ever thought of becoming a priest? Well, the class went crazy, and Scurdy's going to be a priest, Scurdy's going to be a priest. The furthest thing from my mind was that Scurdy was going to be a priest. Got ahead of the plans. So what happens? Go to college, go to St. Mary's Seminary, get ordained, become a priest. All the ups and downs, and again, I was a good student academically, but a pain in the neck every other way, because I, you know, when you're raised by a mother who spoils you, you think you really are God, and you know, not that I thought I was God, but I was pretty close to him, and I was always in trouble, but I would always have someone, a priest, a counselor, get me out of trouble, push me along. And as I'm looking through my life, looking back, you know, God gets what he wants. He wanted me to be a priest. December 8th comes along, and I'm ordained a priest. God wanted me to be a priest. No miracle here. Well, maybe it was a miracle, but no great shakes here. He chose. Now, I almost, not consciously, did everything I could to go away from that ministry, to not be a priest. Not consciously, but just because of the attitude. You know, those are the days they wanted nice holy boys to be priests. Well, that, like that, forget that one. So what happens? I get ordained. And I can look back on my life and even through the scriptures today and realize God pushes us along. God watches us. You are faithful, every one of us. If we are faithful to our call, I don't care if you're single, you're married, you're separated, you're divorced. If you're faithful to your call as a Christian, God pushes you along. It may not look that way. It may look like failure to the world. Well, you're in good company. John lost his head. That looked like a failure. Paul lost his head. That could look like a failure. Jesus died on the cross. That could look like a failure. But you see what values God has? God has eternal values. He doesn't have temporary values. And he places his call in our hearts and invites us to follow him as his servant, as his child, as his friend, as his buddy, as the best friend of his son in the flesh. And sometimes we put ourselves down. We realize, oh, I'm not really, he doesn't want. He does. He wants every one of us and loves every one of us and invites us to love and appreciate ourselves and our mission. I don't care whether you're a faculty member, whether you're a street cleaner, whether you're working in the office, you're a teacher. It doesn't matter. He calls every one of us to be our best selves. You are my son. You are my daughter. I have begotten you. But we could say no. And sometimes we do. We put little barriers between us and the will of God in our lives. But as a baptized Christians, we are all called to be his child, to be the missionary to the earth, to our families, our friends, those with whom we work, in the political arena, in the church arena. Before Mass, what's her name, Marianne was talking about, need to collect food for the hungry. Yes, of course. It goes without blinking an eye, it goes. Of course that's what we're going to do if we are listening to the voice of God in our lives. If we're listening to the voice of God. And sometimes we jumble it up. Sometimes remember as kids you used to put your fingers in, oh, I did, I don't know about you. We put your fingers in your ears and your parents talking, so you wouldn't hear. Sometimes we do that as adults. We put our fingers in our ears so we don't hear God. But he still speaks to us, and God gets what he wants. He won't go against our will. If we go off the path, he nudges us back on. But he gets what he wants. If we are open to him, don't have to all be saints, don't have to all be priests or nuns or married or single, just people. The baptismal sacrament makes us one family, and we're all in charge of each other in that family. We're all called to be people who might be tempted to sway away from God. I don't know about Jesus in his lifetime, how many times he was tempted, how many times he said, Father, what is this all about? I mean, this isn't the plan. Paul himself doubted often. He knew what he had to do, but things are not going his way. People rejected him. They beat him. Isaiah, the same thing. And many of the prophets. But they didn't give up. They were faithful to their call. Let me put it into our context, as Christians, they were faithful to their call, being called by God to be the best possible self. And that's what our call is, to see ourselves through the eyes of our neighbors, of our sisters and brothers, of those around us, to see how we are treating them, because you'll know how you're treating them because the way they treat you back. And when they treat you in a pleasant and loving way, you know you're doing the same thing. But now our job is not to tempt them and push them. So often we take advantage of those we love. Our job is not that. Our job is to love God through them. Again, the poor, yes. The neighbors, yes. The strangers, yes. But our own circle, our own family and friends. Sometimes they get the low item on the totem pole of attention. And we need to give them, in our lives, attention reflecting our faith in God. And you know as well as I do, this is going contradiction to the media. It's contrary to popular thought. Facebook is one, and the others, yeah, all the social medias. They're wonderful. God bless them, and may we always use them correctly. But you know, it's so often they turn out to be me. Come see me. Watch me to smile. Watch me have a drink. My me. And I'm there too. You know what? If you watch Facebook, you see what I'm doing. But we have to do it in a way that respects the me of who we are. And not put God in place of me, of who we are. So yes, take care of ourselves, grow, diet, exercise, do all the wonderful things, provide me time, do all the wonderful things that'll promote us and get us forward. But we're God's children, we're God's lambs, we're God's kids. We're supposed to be faithful to him. So it's time, as we begin the new year, to sit back and realize, what are my talents? And you don't have to have a talent that we know we can identify. Your personality is part of your talent. What is my personality? What is my talent? How can I use it best for myself? I got to be there, but I got to be truthful. For my family, for society. What's the best way I can really emulate my call as a child of God as we begin the unfolding of God's plan for another new year for all of us? And again, take credit where it's due, but you know, you've heard me say more than once, always if somebody says something nice at the end of Mass, you said a nice homily, blah, blah, blah. And I always say, thank the Holy Spirit. That's not a joke. I really mean that. I say it with a smile, thank the Holy Spirit, because all I do is open my mouth. And the other day at Mass, we had the, I had the 7:30 Mass. I don't even know how I got here. I don't do early stuff. But I had, Peter asked me to take 7:30 Mass. I celebrated 7:30 Mass, tiny group of people. And I was supposed to take the 12 that day too, but I couldn't take the 12 because I was going to a funeral of a 23-year-old kid. His mother's a dear friend of mine. She worked together at university. And I wasn't preaching at that Mass, so there was, my heart was enlightened by that. But the scriptures that morning, same day as the funeral Mass, the one that stuck out most in my mind was the psalm, "Harden not your hearts as in the day of Meribah in the desert." And it refers to the people of Israel doubting God was with them as they're going through the desert toward the promised land. And they cursed God, and they grumbled and complained. And the name of the areas are called Meribah and Massah, grumbling and complaining. So I used Alice as a mother who lost her only child, 23-year-old, dynamic, wonderful kid. Suddenly, in the middle of the night, something unusual with his body. She could have certainly been someone who grumbled and complained. She could certainly have been someone who said, "Why me, God?" and gone contradiction to her faith. But Alice called me up and told me that Connor had passed, and she was very happy that she would be doing a reading, and she told me the reading she chose. And she's talking about her only son. She's talking about, and she's a single parent, talking about burying her only son and how she was comforted by the fact of who his personality was, what he was like, and how happy she was to invite me and other priests that knew the kid to Mass and the reading she would do. And I just shared that. And you know, I made it as a homily. And at the end of Mass, a deacon who was here, who I know the name of the deacon in the diocese, I've known him for a long time, but I never knew him personally. And in tears at the end of Mass, he said, "Father," he said, "that was the, I'm not blowing my own horn." He says, "Father, I'm 80 years old. That was the best homily I have ever heard in my life." And it was a short one. It wasn't like this. It was short, right to the point. And I said, "Why?" He says, "You hit everything." And I was moved by it. Thank you. And that's the point I wanted to make. And I said, "Ron, don't thank me. Thank the Holy Spirit who got me here at 7:30 in the morning on the day of that funeral to say this Mass, to reflect on those scriptures for you to hear." I was an instrument. Don't thank me. Thank the Holy Spirit. And that applies to all of us. We need to do the best we can do as we begin our new year. It's not all up to you and me. It's up to us and the Holy Spirit to begin the new year as a member, as Paul says, of the body of Christ, of the ecclesia, of the assembly. As his body, we greet one another and we say, "Happy New Year. Let's begin again and go forward with the Holy Spirit."